So this picture shows a projection onto a plane of that two-dimensional spherical surface which surrounds us, called the surface of our scattering. So this is very much like a map in an atlas, you know, representing the surface of the Earth. This is a two-dimensional map representing the sphere that surrounds us. And what you notice, what's plotted is the temperature of the radiation on that surface as projected forward to the present day. And that temperature varies from point to point on that surface. And these are the fundamental variations of temperature and density which came out of the Big Bang and which later were responsible for the creation of structure in the universe. So these variations are very small in magnitude. The temperature of the surface, as I mentioned, was about 3,000 degrees Kelvin when it emitted the microwave radiation. But the temperature varied from place to place by about one part, by a few parts in 100,000. And so the variations in temperature plotted on this picture are very modest in size, just a few parts in 100,000. But you can see the pattern of temperature variations, and this picture, you know, has been made by a number of beautiful experiments, including the Planck satellite. So we now have access to it. The top curve. Let's start with the bottom curve. The bottom curve shows what happens if I look at this map with a Fourier lens, namely, I Fourier transform it with respect to spherical harmonics on the sky, and then I plot the magnitudes of those spherical harmonics, the average magnitude against L, the harmonic number. And you see this beautiful red curve on the bottom. This was actually predicted in the early 1970s by Jim Peebles and others. And later, Jim Peebles won the Nobel Prize for that. It's a rather clear-cut prediction, but it rests on a particular assumption about the cosmological parameters, which I'll get to in a moment. So the temperature pattern shows this has this oscillatory power spectrum. Above that is the polarization power spectrum, and I'm particularly proud of this because this is a calculation we did for the first time. When I was a young cosmologist. So we calculated the red curve.
Right.
And then, rather amazingly, the data points are the blue points, and you can see they fit perfectly on that curve. Now, the key point is that this is with no free parameters. Okay. You fit the free parameters of the cosmology to the bottom curve, and then just predict the top curve. And it fits spectacularly well. That's not because we were particularly clever with our calculation. We weren't. We simply turned the crank on a way of calculating this invented by Chandrasekhar in the 1930s. But the difference is that we have the data, and we can turn that data into predictions, and they fit beautifully with what we see.
So in other words, for the bottom graph, that's a temperature graph.
Yes.
You have some knobs that you can fiddle with, and these are called the parameters.
That's
how many
right.
are there?
Five.
Just so there five. Are five parameters that go into there.
Yeah.
And then you've developed, when you were a young student,
yes.
a function that takes in those five parameters and outputs that top graph.
Yes.
But those parameters were fixed by someone else for the bottom graph.
Absolutely.
So there were no new parameters you had to introduce for the top one.
We had no freedom to introduce parameters. So all that went into the top curve are the Einstein equations for gravity and the equations for the propagation of radiation, which were, as I say, were developed by Chandrasekhar in the 1930s. And they just used Maxwell's equations and interactions of light with electrons. So we didn't do anything. We were the engineers in this game, okay?
Mm-hmm.
We just took the known laws and applied them. Nobody had bothered to do the top calculation because, frankly, they didn't expect to see it ever measured. And I had to persuade, I persuaded the experimentalists on the Planck satellite to include detectors to measure the polarization. You see, the numbers are tiny. And if you look at the units in the top curve, it's microkelvin squared. So they had to measure the polarization with an accuracy of, you know, a few microkelvin, 2 or 3 microkelvin. That's a very big task.
Yes. Well, you must not have been just some whippersnapper then to have such influence over someone to develop such a sophisticated tool by merely suggesting it.
Well, I was lucky. As I say, all the equations were lying around in the literature. Nobody had bothered. Actually, some people had bothered, but they'd gotten it wrong. You can make lots of mistakes in theoretical calculations. You know, we, as far as I know, we were the first people who actually did it seriously and correctly, and we got the curve, and it agrees beautifully. So this just, this changed, was a turning point in my career, because you look at this curve and you say, my goodness, the universe is simple, right?
Mm-hmm.
We have 5 basic parameters, as I'll explain in a moment. We fit those to some data set, right? Could be the temperature in the lower curve, could be the galaxy distribution, many other forms of data. So fit it to some data and predict everything else. And the claim is that everything we see is fit by these 5 parameters. And you can measure those 5 parameters in multiple ways, right? And they, this is called the Lambda CDM model. And it really, it's amazing that it's so simple and fit, and so far fits everything. And the more and more data we've got, the better the fit. It's really quite remarkable. There are always some tensions. People claim the Hubble constant isn't quite consistent and so on. But be very careful about believing those, because quite often they are later, you know, found to be wrong. And many of them are only 2 sigma or 2.5 sigma. So far...
So that's what you were referring to earlier in the talk when you said, don't believe every rumor.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
I see. So every week or every year, there's a new tension or anomaly.
Absolutely. And most of them fade away and people forget about them. What has survived is a remarkably simple model, which, as I say, seems to be consistent, you know, within 3 sigma or 4 sigma I mean, particle physicists like to use 5 sigma. They never believe anything less than 5 sigma, and that's a good rule. I would say, actually, in applying it to cosmology, cosmological measurements are much more difficult to control than particle physics experiments. They're not in the lab. You know, you're measuring the natural universe. And I would say our criterion for accepting a measurement should be stronger than 5 sigma. If it's 5 sigma in particle physics, surely in cosmology it's got to be 7 or 8 sigma. If you apply that criterion, there are no anomalies, okay, with this model.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.